Welcome to Lyon, our base for exploring the region of France as best known for its world-famous gastronomic culture.
In this episode, we explore the streets and sites of the UNESCO World Heritage Site and examine the global influence of Lyon's culinary traditions. It's all about the legendary Lyonnaise lifestyle this week.
I'm David Celdran, and this is Executive Class.
Even for savvy travelers, little is known about the southeastern French city of Lyon. The picturesque city, the third largest in France, is in the region of the country called the Rhone Alps, owing to its location closer to French Alps and the mighty Rhone River that cuts through it. The historic heart of Lyon is actually traversed by two rivers that meet at its southern tip, the Rhone on the east and the Saône on the west. The dual link to the waterways of Europe and the fertile soil of its banks made Lyon the perfect place for early settlers. The city was once the capital of the Gauls in Roman times, but no one really remembers that anymore. Because for those outside France, the only capital Lyon is known as today is that of gastronomy. The area around Lyon produces some of the best wines, beef, and vegetables in France, not to mention top chefs like Paul Bocuse, named Chef of the Century by the Culinary Institute of America. Here, honored by his colleagues, the best international chefs in a ceremony in Lyon City Hall. But there's much more to enjoy in Lyon than its world-famous cuisine and celebrity chefs. Surely, it's no Paris in terms of iconic monuments and grand boulevards, but a thoughtful guide like Clarisse Pignon can help you enjoy parts of the city that are beautiful beyond the obvious. Clarisse is an artist and professional dancer, so she sees Lyon from a different perspective. No wonder, instead of first heading to the major sites, Clarisse took me to this obscure corner of the city instead, a monument that's not even mentioned in most guidebooks. It's a touching tribute to one of Lyon's most famous sons, the aviator and novelist Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, author of the beloved classic Le Petit Prince, The Little Prince. Exupéry disappeared while flying over the south of France, but he, along with his most famous creation, live on in Lyon's memory.
The entire inscription is written in French, but you'll recognize some keywords. For example, Antoine de Saint-Exupéry was born in Lyon on June 29, 1900. And for sure, you'll also recognize this one. It's his famous verse. Is only the heart that one can see rightly. What is essential is invisible to the eye. For sure you know that one.
Indeed, in Lyon, what is essential is often beneath the surface. Follow your heart instead. It might take you to unexpected places. No doubt Lyon is a beautiful city, elegant, but not overly opulent. I love it because it's built on a human scale, easily covered by foot, in a half day even. It helps that many avenues are off limits to cars, as are many of its main squares. Place Bellecour at one end of Rue de la République is the largest pedestrian-only square in Europe. 17th century square surrounded by the Renaissance buildings Lyon is known for. In the middle stands an equestrian statue of King Louis XIV, the man who established the square during his reign. On either side are allegorical statues of the two rivers that run through the city, the Saône and the Rhône. At the opposite end of Rue de la République is Place de Turreau, where some of the city's grandest Renaissance buildings stand, the Beaux-Arts Museum and the Hôtel de Ville, City Hall. The square is also the new home of the majestic Fontaine Bartholdi, named after its creator, Frédéric Bartholdi, who sculpted New York's Statue of Liberty. The fountain was bought from the city of Bordeaux, which couldn't afford to pay Bartholdi for it. It depicts France and the chariot pulled by horses, symbolizing the four great rivers of the country. A short walk away is yet another public square with an equally grandiose structure at its center. The neoclassical opera house of the Opera Nationale de Lyon, renamed the Opera Nouvelle after the architect Jean Nouvel, who redesigned it in 1986. Like foodie arts have a religious following in Lyon, at the center of the lovely Place de Célestins is a Théâtre Célestin. Established in 1792, the Italianate theater building has been hosting top French talent since. At the end of every year, the theater lights up for Lyon's annual Fête de Lumière festival. Even the lights here are theatrical. In Lyon, it's not just your heart that helps you navigate the streets, but your nose too. Follow the aroma of Lyonnaise cuisine in the air, and you'll come across one of the city's many public markets. One of the friendliest in town is Marché Saint-Antoine, along the east bank of the Saône River. Cheese from the surrounding Rhône Alps is a specialty of the market. Tasting is encouraged, so take your pick from the dozens of local varieties made from goat, sheep, and cow's milk. A local favorite is a mild, semi-soft Tome de Savoie from the French Alps nearby. Cheese is one of Lyon's and a Rhône specialties, so don't pass up the chance to taste it at its source. Dry and cured sausages, called saucisson by the French, are another Rhône delicacy. The Lyonnais love pork, cured pork especially, and the charcuterie from the area is known as the absolute best in France. There's a mind-boggling variety of sausages in the market. Saucisson with cheese, nuts, mushrooms, all at very affordable prices. I suggest stocking up on the local Rosette du Lyon. Its fine wine flavor and long finish make it the most popular saucisson in France. Follow your nose even further up the river, and you'll come across another Lyonnais gastronomic institution, épiceries and historic bistros called Bouchons in Lyon. We stop for a café at an épicerie, French for a specialty grocery shop. In Lyon, épiceries also serve meals. This one, simply called L'Épicerie, is a good example of how locals prefer to dine in a casual and unpretentious environment. It's the same raw atmosphere you find in a bouchon. At Chez Chabert, in the historic Vieux Lyon district, there are no frills here, no fancy table settings, no frou-frou. The focus is on the food. But be prepared, because it might not be what you expect from a capital of gastronomy.
I think it's nose and head.
It's okay.
Of the pork.
It's okay.
Okay, let's be clear. Bouchon cuisine is unlike the delicate food you come across in Paris. It's rustic, with a lot of offal, with all sorts of parts from the cow and pig on the menu, both served as cold hors d'oeuvres in salads. It's for the adventurous foodie, or gluttons on a budget. For a fixed price, say 25 euro, you get up to 8 dishes plus the main course of your choice. Not bad.
Our first meal in
Lyon. Yeah.
The staff just keep let it coming and stuff your table with dish on top of dish. Apart from the cow's muzzle, there's charcuterie from parts of the pig I'd rather not mention.
What did you say this was?
Veal feet.
Oh, that's interesting. Veal feet.
I'm familiar with and really do like veal, but I've never tasted a calf's foot before.
And this is, a cow's nose.
There's no pressure to eat everything on the table. Even a French lady like Clarisse isn't up to much of it.
How about you?
Yes, sausage, pork sausage.
Okay.
The less experimental will enjoy the more familiar taste of sliced pork sausages. And if you're not into this kind of meat, the bottomless servings of lentils, white beans, beetroot, and potato salad are guaranteed to satisfy before the main dish is served.
Lyon is a sausage and charcuterie capital of France. If you're planning on moving to the city, make sure to try one of their famous sausages.
My main course is a Lyonnaise specialty, andouillette. A sausage of pork, veal tripe, herbs, and spices encased in pig's intestine. It tastes much better than it sounds, and heavier than it looks. But it's truly superb and highly recommended. Recommended too is some serious walking after visiting Abuchon. A stroll along the cobblestone streets near the Abuchon is a good way to digest your meal, while enjoying the scenery in the old quarter at the same time. When we come back after the break, we'll continue our tour of Lyon through old covered passageways and up the city's ancient hillside before hitting the tables one last time. The rest of our tour of France's gastronomic capital and back home for a taste of provincial French cuisine. We'll have all that and more when Executive Class returns. We're back in Lyon, where after a heavy meal at a traditional bouchon, we're looking to shed off some pounds while exploring the old quarter of town, including one of its most peculiar attractions, secret covered passageways called Traboulet. Traboulets were once used by silk traders and craftsmen to keep their goods dry while transporting their goods to and from merchant ships docked on the river. Only a few traboulets have been open to the public. These narrow, covered lanes sneak through entire neighborhoods and serve as convenient shortcuts in bad weather, or in the case of Lyon's past, tunnels during revolt. The longest traboulet takes you to Rue Saint-Jean, one of Lyon's oldest and liveliest streets. At one end of it is a Gothic Saint-Jean Cathedral, built in honor of Saint John the Baptist, whose statue adorns a pedestrian square. The Place Saint-Jean is where tourists and worshippers begin the ascent to Lyon's other important religious pilgrimage site, the Basilica de Notre-Dame at the peak of Mont Fourvier. There's a funicular for those who can't handle the climb on foot, but for penitents and gluttons alike, the workout is a blessing. And so is this. From the courtyard of the Basilica is the best view possible of Lyon, the Rhone, and the French Alps beyond.
If Paris has Montmartre, Lyon has Mont Fourvier. It's the absolute best way to start and end your stay in Lyon. The view is simply stunning.
Unlike Paris, however, the skyline of Lyon is less dramatic. A flat mass of red-tiled rooftops, interrupted here and there by church towers and the cavities formed by the squares of the city and the two rivers that run through it. But that's Lyon for you. Like its people and food, unpretentious and real. The wine bar Georges V is a Lyonnaise institution famous for the quality and diversity of its wines, most from the vineyards of Burgundy and Rhone Valley close by. Joining me for Tapas and Wine is Jean-Philippe Fontaine, a top executive of the French high-end audio speaker manufacturer Focal JM Lab. Professionals like Jean-Philippe can't get enough of the place, an unpretentious gastropub that specializes in top-notch wines without the sticker shock or the fancy marketing. The tapas are also great. For starters, a typical plate of charcuterie, washed down with a glass of refreshing Tokaj from Hungary. Listed among the top 10 wine cellars in the world by Wine Traveler magazine, the menu is built around their wines, so food and wine match perfectly. Bottles are passed from table to table, pretty much bottomless, and you never know what's coming next. A small batch wine from Nîmes, or one from the tiny northern Rhone village of Saint-Péray. It's all up to George, the owner who serves what he thinks you'll enjoy, and charges a fixed price for it all. The gastronomic traditions of cities like Lyon have helped give French cuisine a fresh and more approachable image to the rest of the world. This changing perception is fueled by new interest in authentic and rustic cooking from France.
French cuisine is like any other cuisine in the world. It takes its roots in the countryside. What makes the difference with French cuisine is that maybe the French chefs are a little bit more creative, and they always take this basic food and try to enhance it and come up with diverse recipes also, no? But it really takes its roots in the countryside.
Chef Eric Costil is part of a new generation of chefs championing this back-to-basic style of French cooking.
Haute cuisine is really a version, in more technical version of the home cooking style, but what I like to do, especially in a restaurant like Spiral, is a cuisine that everybody can understand. Simple flavors, but authentic flavors, and home style cooking, the cooking of the mothers.
Last month, Chef Eric and his team at the French luxury hotel chain Sofitel celebrated the centennial of the Tour de France with a culinary journey of their own, featuring a month-long festival of the different regional cuisines of France. Food that's approachable and, above all, flavorful. That's the same thinking behind Chef Ian Padilla's newly opened Brasserie Girolle along the strip in the fort. It's Chef Ian's second venture in Manila since returning from a stint at the legendary two Michelin-starred restaurant Taiwan in Paris.
Working in these restaurants, I could never afford to eat there, especially not my salary. So I took refuge to eating in brasseries, bistros, where the food was much cheaper. And you realize that French fine dining is actually based on peasant food.
The brasserie is a departure from the posh interiors and elaborate menu of La Girolle, the French fine dining restaurant he opened in late 2011. Both La Girolle and his new brasserie serve classic French cuisine. But the approach to each is vastly different.
Classical French food, in my opinion, is actually peasant in nature. You go out of Paris, you go to Lyon, you go to Bordeaux, you'll have like braised duck legs with olives, you'll have beef stewed in red wine, you'll have a pâté made of the unprized bits, so to speak, sausages and cheese, simple breads. That, in my opinion, is authentic French food.
And that's exactly what you get at Brasserie Girolle. Authentic, honest, and hearty dishes that warm the soul as much as your tummy. Dishes I've been craving for since returning from Lyon. Like a plate of escargot, the classic dish of snails. The best snails are picked from the countryside outside Lyon and served with herb garlic butter. Another brasserie staple is steak tartare. The delicate taste of the raw ground beef mixed in a medley of herbs, spices, and sauces is simply superb. And for those that prefer something more thoroughly cooked and full-flavored, The beef bourguignon, braised in red Rhone wine for 8 hours in the pot, is a hearty alternative. Brasseries are the French equivalent of pubs and bars, and good affordable wines are another feature of Giraud, enjoyed with food in an easy and relaxed atmosphere that brings French cuisine closer down to earth.
Cheers. Cheers.
Like fresh and quality produce, wines are an integral part of French cuisine and French culture. That's perhaps why wine is unfairly considered a drink for snobs. Planet Grapes at a Tuscany in McKinley Hill hopes to debunk that notion with a fresh and unpretentious approach to enjoying wine.
The biggest barrier for people enjoying wine is they get anxious, they get nervous, because they find wine too mysterious, and too complex, and very hard to understand. So by having the tagline, wine without the drama, we're sending out the message that, hey, you know, wine is only a beverage, an alcoholic beverage, but unlike other alcoholic beverage like beer or vodka, it needs a little bit of effort to understand and appreciate.
Planet Grapes is from the same company behind the upscale specialist wine shop, Wine Story. But instead of top-tier wines from Bordeaux, Burgundy, and Napa Valley, the wines here are much more affordable and served by the glass if you want. A tasting portion of a very decent French Syrah from the south of Lyon starts at only 105 pesos. All wines are introduced by grape variety or their flavor profile, with easy-to-understand tasting notes to remove all the guessing.
Thank you. Street food needs wine. That's the philosophy of Planet Grapes. It's to make wine drinking approachable, not intimidating. In fact, what could be more comforting than pairing a glass of French wine with a humble Pinoy balut?
By reminding customers that yes, that French-sounding Sauvignon Blanc actually pairs well with balut, or that Napa Valley Chardonnay is a good match for dim sum or shawmai, a lot of the anxiety that comes with enjoying wine is removed.
We don't have the drama. Just sit down, pour the glass of wine, enjoy the food, and it's really pay attention to your company, to your friends, whoever you're with.
And that's precisely the Lyonnaise way. Food and wine without all the contrived drama we associate with French gastronomy. Indeed, you are what you eat and how you like to eat. And that's why Lyon, despite its striking beauty and glorious history, is like a familiar friend, warm and endearing. Definitely worth remembering. La France, la France,
and that's all for this episode of Executive Class. I'm David Celdran. Thanks for watching.